Ready? We are recording.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, Alex.
What's up, y'all?
If folks feel comfortable to do so, please add your gender pronouns to your display name. If you don't know how to do that, you can just click on the little blue ellipses in the corner and it'll let you rename yourself.
Oh yeah. Okay. Perfect. So I can go. All right. So welcome, everybody. Tonight, our class is going to be on abolition art and music and movements. We're going to be hearing from Frisco Lens, the Brass Liberation Orchestra, Stephanie Woodford, and Tongo Eisen-Martin. So next week, we'll have our last speaker session where we will do a healing space together with the Freedom Community Clinic, and we will have a cohort only meeting on 12-1 and 12-8 to reflect our Build Abolition 101 at CCSF project. How and if we should proceed with creating an introductory abolition course at CCSF. So folks who are a part of the cohort, join us in December. So we're coming up towards the end of our time together and excited to see how we find ways to stay connected outside of this and beyond to the burning of all the prisons. today we'll be discussing abolition and art, like I mentioned. Tongo Eisen-Martin is the SF Poet Laureate who will do a workshop on resistance poetry. Frisco Lens will discuss their work in photography, and the Brass Liberation Orchestra will talk about how they incorporate music and movement and jazz musician. And CCSF alumni Stephanie Woodford will perform Blackbird by Nina Simone. I'm Alex and I use they, them pronouns, and my visual description, if I can see myself, hold on. I have a blurred background that has a blurry plant, and I have long brown hair and a ponytail. I have silver hoops on, and I am femme presenting with a light brown skin, and I come from Filipino and Jewish heritage. And I have a gray t-shirt on.
Hey everyone, I'm Tatiana. I use they, them pronouns. I'm a tired ass looking, light skinned Latinx Jewish person. I have long brown hair, I'm wearing some hoops, and I'm also wearing a gray sweater. Behind me, you can see my kitchen with light wood paneling, and I have a couple rings on my fingers. I'm gonna go ahead and do the I'm gonna go ahead and do the lens acknowledgement as well. I'm so excited to have everyone here and to hear from everyone. We acknowledge that San Francisco is located on the unceded ancestral homeland of the Remetush Ohlone peoples, who were the original inhabitants of the San Francisco Peninsula. We encourage non-Indigenous members to uplift the work of rematriation and land taxes. And we have a link in the chat, I think, that will take you to pay your settler land taxes. Thank you, Ara. And tonight and in this space always, we want to be intentional with how we are creating Black, Indigenous, and POC-centered spaces. We want to move forward by creating practices to prioritize BIPOC members and proactively decenter whiteness and dismantle white supremacy, anti-Blackness, misogynoir, and colorism. Because of that, we will open our facilitated discussion to be open only to BIPOC first, centering LGBTQ+ and disabled BIPOC, with the last 5 minutes being open to all, such as non-BIPOC. We are mindful of creating BIPOC-centered spaces in the breakout rooms. Please DM the person marked host in the meeting if you are a white person. Please do this so that we can mindfully arrange the breakout rooms. The chat is open to everyone. However, we do ask white folks to please be mindful over taking up too much space. The Zoom sessions will continue to be open for anyone to join. Sorry, there was one last thing. So we do have a mutual aid fund that will go toward paying our speakers for presenting to us with payments toward Black, Indigenous, and POC speakers prioritized. We are also organizing an art auction, which will have proceeds paying our speakers and also provide mutual aid to cohort members in need. So, and then, yes. And we typically do have our care collective members, Tara and Kari, providing collective care for us during the session with BIPOC prioritized. Unfortunately, they are both unable to be present tonight. And so we are encouraging folks to take a break if you are feeling triggered or re-traumatized by the content being discussed. I'm so glad that they are both taking time to take care of themselves. They've really shown up for us and the cohort this entire semester. Our Zoom moderators will share the anonymous care form in the chat where you can provide feedback on the session. Collective care is central to abolition, as we have learned in our previous sessions. And also, I know that we have some Project Survive folks in the house. I'm myself a member of Project Survive. And if you, at any point in time, need any kind of care, I volunteer to be somebody that you can reach out to. And I'm gonna go ahead and pass it back to Alex to introduce Frisco Lens.
Thank you, Tatiana. And I echo that too. I'm also a part of Project Survive. And so in the same capacity, Tatiana and I are here for folks. And so next up, I have the pleasure of introducing a good friend of mine. We go way back to middle school, and I've watched him grow so much. And now he's here presenting tonight as Frisco Lens, or Jesus, who is a Frisco native capturing pictures and videos that he comes across on a daily basis from a Frisco lens. He's also a part of Lowriders for Justice and many other community organizations. And he will speak tonight about how his art connects with abolition. Welcome, Jesus.
Thank you, Alex, and thank you for inviting me into this space. Definitely highly appreciate and respect all the ground rules set, you know, and the land acknowledgement. So that's definitely dope. Let me describe myself real quick. It's my first time doing this, so thanks for putting me on. Brown skin, male, Mexican, got a ponytail, black t-shirt, and I guess a goatee. I don't know if you guys know what setup is, but there's like a lowrider like background that I got on my screen with a setup, which is like a colorful blanket that we use, you know, in the motherland. And yeah, that's a 51 Dodge behind me in the back. But with that being said, I wanted to ask if I could get co-host options so I could share my screen. Let me see. Okay, thank you. Let me give it a shot. There we go. I'm a visual person, so I'll be talking, but him pronouns. But just introduction of myself. My name is Jesus Coba, born and raised here, you know, Hunters Point Mission District, you know, both are my homes, a lot of love and respect. And yeah, I'll be talking about art, photography, and how it ties into abolition. So as you can see, I'll be talking a little bit about myself too, and why abolition is important to me. I've been incarcerated and on probation since I was 13. And I've been, you know, in group homes. I turned 15 in one. I've been in county jail, and not in any sense of glorifying any of that, but it's just to show that I'm definitely been impacted by the system, and definitely feel like that's something that we need to abolish. It's inhumane. And there's still a lot of my friends that I could say me and both Alex know that grew up there are currently still in the system there, which is why it's important for us to talk about these topics and provide alternatives. I've been working in the nonprofit world for over 10 years, not to glorify that industry either, but just to show that I know the ins and outs of the numbers and the money and grants and the city funding and all that stuff too. So yeah, just throw that out there as well. And yeah, involved in a lot of like activism, more towards abolition, towards police and liberation of Black and Brown folks and Indigenous folks. This first picture I have here is a 64 Impala. It's actually my old one. I took this picture like in 2015, and it's an orange 64 Impala. And if you look closely, I have a Mexican flag and a Pan-African flag to signify Black and Brown unity. I grew up in a predominantly Black neighborhood. I grew up in Bayview Hunters Point from the Mission, but like, it's like Hunters Point is my own. Like the first time I went to the store by myself, the first time I caught the bus by myself, everything, a lot of my firsts are in the Point. And I got a lot of love, a lot of homies there. So when I have those, it's to signify Black and Brown unity. If you look in the back even further, there's some graffiti, which is a form of resistance and rebellion on the wall that says Keep Hoods Yours, you know, which is a graffiti crew here in the city. If you guys are familiar with them, definitely anti-gentrification, anti-yuppie hipsters, anti-anything that's not, you know, Black and Brown and liberation of our people. So it's a mixture of different things. This is one of the first pictures that I took many years ago. But yeah, the next image, and one thing I want to talk about, I didn't start photography trying to become a photographer. That wasn't even a goal, or that wasn't even a plan. I picked up a camera because I was doing copwatching. That's originally why I got a camera. I had a camera phone. I was out in the community just recording and documenting the police, harassing people. I was taking classes so I could learn my rights. And this wasn't like in an organized fashion. This was literally just me. I got tired of being on Facebook and Instagram and seeing all this posts. I'm like, bro, I got to get onto the streets, bro. I can't just post about this stuff. Like, it's a lot of crazy things going on. So at first, I wasn't a photographer. I was just like a lot of protests. I was at a lot of just in the streets. This one right here is on 16th and Cap. And you can see a brown man being detained by SAPD. Two SAPD officers, both male. And they're both wearing masks. The one on the left bumped into me while I was documenting the situation. I did a lot of video recording, but this is just a picture that I took. But yeah, it's essentially, when I first started doing this, I started doing cop watching. That's what I started doing at first. And after that, I think one time I had bought a camera because I needed higher resolution. Some of my camera phones back then, they were just really blurry. They weren't the best. So I picked up a camera, I invested in it, I saved up, and I started going out. And I guess one time I was at Twin Peaks. I used to go there a lot, just smoke and get high and chill and relax and look at the city. And then I saw a beautiful view of the city, and I was like, wow, man, like, that'd be dope if I could take a picture, right? And then I had my camera in my trunk, and I'm just like, well, I can't use the camera. That's for like just cop watching and protests and stuff. So then I was like, says who? Like, that's your camera, dude. You can do whatever you want. So I grabbed my camera and I took a picture of the city right there at Twin Peaks. And it was like so beautiful. The sky was clear. It was pre-COVID and people were out. It was just a beautiful sight, the bridge. And yeah, that was my first, I'm not gonna say my first photography, but my first shot where I'm like, okay, I want to pursue photography. Like, this is something I want to do. This is dope, you know? So yeah, that's what started off for me. But originally it started with copwatching, just so folks know. This picture right here is at a protest, 2016. This is the Frisco 5 hunger strike, Frisco 500. For those of you who know, Frisco 500 is a group that mobilized after the Frisco 5 hunger strike in solidarity with the folks. And in the picture, you're going to see Equipto and Edwin Lindo in wheelchairs being pushed by the doctors from the Do No Harm Coalition. You see they're wearing a white coat with an SF shirt. And they were out of it. I think this was after 17 days of not eating and only drinking water. There's a man in a blue shirt holding a sign. And you can't see his face, but that man is Equipto's father. He was right next to him. I didn't learn this until years later. He's like, oh, it's my dad. When Lindo's wearing a white brim with a black strap around it, and they're covered in coats. Equipto's wearing shades. They both have goatees and beards. And this was a powerful image, you know. I had met Equipto and Edwin Lindo a couple of times at a few, you know, actions, but this was, you know, when I was still, you know, just getting my feet wet out there. I was doing a lot of activism kind of on my own. I didn't really know no one, but I was just out there in the streets just like, bro, I'm tired of seeing people get killed on camera. I've been harassed and beat up by the police. I've been arrested for things I didn't do. I got hit with the Crown Vic, you know, with the car that they drive. And yeah, man, I'm definitely against the system. Definitely, I didn't even know what the word abolition was back then, but I was like definitely strongly against any kind of authority or law enforcement. And, you know, I'm not a bad person. A lot of people tend to think, you know, I'm pretty sure a lot of you know, they hear abolition, they think you're wild and radical and crazy and just, you know, you don't know better, but they don't know how like invested and passionate we are and highly educated on the topic, because it's not just about abolishing the current racist system. It's also about like providing a community-centered alternative, which a lot of us, we do a lot of the work already. You know, it's not, we're not a fix it all, but it's definitely not, whatever's going on right now, that's not it. You know, definitely not it. This was also in 2016, before Trump came into office. This next image is of my friend Chewy. It went viral back then. I didn't have a watermark or nothing, so all kinds of people were sharing it. But he's holding a sign. He's wearing a gray hoodie. He has a fake haircut, and it says, "Welcome to Aztlan, deport Donald Trump." Now, this is definitely a lonely land, you know, and with all due respect, and I'm definitely respect that. This is just a sign that, you know, he was holding at the time. There's a Mexican flag on top of him. But this image, I remember, because this is the first time where I really started seeing like flat, blunt white supremacists come into the Bay Area. Like, I've dealt with racism, you know, with like liberals and just microaggressions. And, you know, a couple of people have gotten to a couple of fights here and there, but this is the first time they're out here just like, go back to your country and you don't belong here. And they're using the F word and the N word. And there's a lot of scuffles, and a lot of people got a lot of white supremacists and racists. And there's a couple of brown and black folks on their side as well. I won't lie, upholding white supremacy. They got, you know, hurt that day coming into this space, trying to bring hate into our Bay Area. The city that it took place was in Burlingame, but that's as closest to San Francisco and Oakland you're going to get. So we took it to Burlingame. And that's the same day you could look into an article where Donald Trump had to hop over like a freeway overpass and escorted by the police to get to where he was supposed to speak, because we weren't allowing it. Pigs were getting eggs thrown at them. Fences were being knocked down. It was a historic day. It was beautiful. Took a lot of videos, you know, but this is just the image I was able to find. I had to do a lot of digging back, because I also lost my camera throughout time. I had my car broken into and camera went missing, right? But I don't really care about the camera. I wish I could have held on to those SD cards and stuff. All right, I'm gonna move forward with the next image. So besides activism and just being out there, I'm really like taking pictures of what I see like from a Frisco lens. You know, that the name is basically, I've seen a lot of people come in San Francisco taking pictures of San Francisco, telling their point of view, their story. I'm like, I'm from Frisco. I grew up here, like, and I go to places where y'all don't go. Like, I'd be like in the hoods with my camera, you know, and I could document something y'all usually won't see. And I want to tell that story, you know, I want to share that, you know. And I think my first pictures, like I said, when I took pictures at Twin Peaks, right after I went to Oakdale Projects, and then I went to Army Street and Mission, where they recently had burned down the building on 22nd and Mission, where my cousin was living in on top of the Popeyes, and she was houseless for a while, you know. So there was an arsonist that started a fire so they could get that property. But yeah, this next image is at in the Mission District at an event. You see a 64 Chevy Impala, the same orange one from earlier, just a friend of it. You see my friend Julia, who is a danzante, a Mexica danzante. So she has her green feathers and you know, traditional clothing with her daughter. I think she's also involved with the danzantes, which means the Aztec dancing. And they're both standing in front of the Impala, which is pretty dope, you know, because danzante is one thing and low riding is another thing. But to collide the two and put them together, it's like a culture clash, you know what I'm saying? So I definitely put that there. And it's a beautiful image. There's a couple other cars. You see a Victorian in the back. It's like gray and white. And then you got a 1946 Dodge on the right. And I only know that because that's my friend's car, my homie Ray. Other than that, I wouldn't have, you know, guessed that on the spot. But it's a beautiful image. It's definitely, you know, it's my friend. And I also know her. Her partner, who, you know, he's doing time. I grew up with the guy too. He got out, but at the time he was currently still incarcerated. As you can see, like, incarceration is like a regular part of our lives, you know, in my community. You know, it's just sad, and we miss folks. Yeah, you know, he's back home now, fortunately, you know, but some people, they don't get that, you know. I'm gonna move forward. This is Malcolm X. This is in Oakland, California. I know for a while I was like, so if I'm Frisco Lens, can I take pictures in other cities? Like, should I do it? And, you know, I'm a loving person. I always got a lot of love at diversity and how different people are or what things we got in common. And I love Oakland, bro. Oakland's beautiful, man. Like, it's one of the most beautiful places in the world, man, you know? And this next image is of Malcolm X. It's at a bookstore. I think this is at 38 or 39th Street. I can't even see. 39th Street and Martin Luther King. And it's the image, the powerful image of Malcolm X. It's a mural holding his rifle by the door, but it's actually books next to him. And then there's a Pan-African flag on top, which is red, black, and green, which signifies unity amongst all Black folks of African descent. Regardless of where you were born or located in the world, right? But I thought this was a powerful image. It's in Oakland. It represents Black culture. It represents revolution and resistance. And it represents so many things to me, you know? And I captured it. This is years old too. But like I said, I definitely put an emphasis on like Black and brown, you know, solidarity and unity. We mean or matter more than any other folks, but we're the ones that are impacted the most. We're the ones that go through it the most in terms of like highest rates of incarceration, higher rates of poverty, highest rates of discrimination. So, you know, I'm going to center it. This is my story, right? So that's how I tell it. Let me see. Moving forward in terms of the art, this right here is my brother, rest in peace, Zumbi from the Zionite crew. We recently lost him, man. He was a good, beautiful soul. Man, I ain't never met no one, too many people like him. You know, and I'm not going to say we were hella close because we weren't. I met him through, you know, just documenting hip hop. I got cool with some Frisco rappers and I started traveling with them and taking pictures. And, you know, this particular photo, though, man, that guy on the left, he's a young Hawaiian young man. I'm sorry, let me explain the image. There's a Hawaiian young man, and then there's Zumbi from Zion, a Black brother, and they're holding fists, they're holding hands together, and they're looking at each other directly in the eye. And it's a dark space, but the lights are like purple and red and violet, so it looks dope. It's a dope image, but this guy, he was out, my friends were out there freestyling in the parking lot, and he came with his ukulele and started playing the ukulele while they were freestyling, right? And then he was like, what's going on here today? Like, oh man, we got people performing, we're from the city. Then we were like out in Fairfax in the 707. And he was like, you think they'll let me play my ukulele? I was like, oh shit, give it a shot, bro. Fuck it, why not? Like, and he came in there kind of shy, nervous, and timid. He was with his dad and his sister. And he came in there and he was kind of just in the bag, and we're all having a good time. We're just turning up pre-COVID. A lot of these are pre-COVID. And then Zumbi's just like, hey, you, come on stage. And the guy's like, who, me? And we're like, yeah, we pushed him. And he buys ukulele. He let him perform. And he started freestyling while he was playing the ukulele on stage in front of everybody. And his dad and his sister were hella proud of him. It was just a beautiful moment. And I had a lot of love for Zumbi for that. I was like, he's like, I like spontaneous folks. I like on the spot. I like people who live life like, you know what I'm saying? That don't hold back or just do something in the moment. I'm the type of people like, yeah, let's go to LA so we can fuck it, let's go. Like, you know, just free, man. You know, it's all about freedom. Freedom is a beautiful thing, you know, and that's what I do in my photography. So I'm also careful who I take pictures of and who I don't. Because as a photographer, when you start taking pictures of people that are like sellouts or like harmful to the movement, then you're like accepting them. Or you're like saying they're cool. Because if I take a picture and I post it, like, oh, look, he's cool because he's an abolitionist and he took a picture of him, so it should be all good. And it's like I'm lying or fooling to the people, and I can't do that. Now, not to say I've taken pictures of people that later on in life I figured out, fuck, shouldn't have done that, you know? But it happens, right? I mean, some people don't show their true colors, you know? They're hiding their cards in front of them. But it's a beautiful image and a beautiful memory, y'all. Also about the art. So we got culture, activism, art. This right here is a mural my homie Chris Gonzalez did over there on Market by the freeway exit, I think by Castro. It's a beautiful image, and I'm definitely in solidarity with my folks in the Middle East with, you know, Free Palestine, anti-Zionist. And, you know, let me explain the image actually. It's a beautiful wall. A building, it's like blue and red, and it's a blue sky, but in the sky there's like patterns, and the buildings are like yellow and orange, reddish, and they're outlined in black. And then there's like a woman and a man like behind a wall climbing it, and you know, it's just beautiful. Like, I know a mural is already a mural and it's done, so it's not like you really gotta do something in terms of photography, but I try to make it my own. I got the freeway overpass, I got the building and the ladder on the side, I got the buildings on the side. And you know, always give credit where it's due. If you're a photographer and you capture a mural, try to find out who the artist is. And if you look at closely at the very bottom behind those bushes, you can see his name. But I knew it was his image already. That's my boy Abby. He be showing me how to paint. I also like to paint, you know. So he's a good dude, definitely dope art, been doing this for years, different murals along the way. But I think another thing I want to say, we talked about standing in solidarity with Free Palestine and anti-Zionism and Black and Brown unity. If there's any form of oppression, that could also mean classism and capitalism, you know, any kind of oppression around the world, you got to stand in solidarity. Even if you're not fully educated, you got to learn as much as you can. Don't expect any of that to be taught in school. Fortunately, you're here at this City College class on abolition, which, damn, that's pretty dope. Props to y'all. I was excited when I heard about it, y'all. But if you allow that, then any day could be you and your folks next. Or, you know, the more you allow people to get away with in terms of like people in power, the more doors you open. You know what I'm saying? And one thing I will talk about, I'm not in this whole debate of vaccine, anti-vaccine. I'm not going to tell people what to do with their lives and stuff. But like, if you have to force something on anybody, whatever it is, that opens the door to like force more things on whatever those things may be in the future. You know what I'm saying? So like I said, I'm not for it. People do whatever you want. I'm all about freedom. As long as you're not hurting no one, do whatever the fuck you want, dude. Like, go live your life. Just don't hurt no one along the way, right? And that's just me as an individual. Let me see. That's next image is a beautiful 68 Impala It's blue, it's patterned out with like pink and purple pinstripes. It's in Clarion Alley, and it's like from the top down. And I love lowriders. That's another thing about me that just comes with it. I wear multiple hats. But this is my homie's ride. We did a photo shoot, and next to his ride is a mural that's like sky blue with like Mexica figures next to it. They're orange and red and white, and you know, basically Aztec art. And he parked right next to it. Some of the imagery he has on the back of his vehicle is also of the same art. And I just thought it was a beautiful image. I love Clarion Alley. Clarion Alley is like a home to me. I could fucking be there all day, night, and obviously be precautious, but it's like home. It's like where are the people that people be worried about, even though we're not doing nothing when it comes to the alley. But look out for those guys, you know. But we also did a mural for Zumbi here too, right after he passed away. Shout out to Mel Waters, and shout out to all the artists in this alley, man. And hopefully there's been a Zionist coming to this alley crossing out our murals, so we constantly come through trying to catch somebody, see if they'll do it. But they always do it like when no one's around, they know they can get away with it and stuff like that. But our art is like a form of resistance. It's a form of rebellion. It's beautiful. That's something the opposition doesn't got. They don't got as much talented artists as we do on our side. So I think that's pretty dope, whether it's music, poetry, whether it's culture or murals or painting, like photography. We got so much like richness, and I'm pretty sure it definitely fucks with them. But we're beautiful people, y'all. So definitely something I like to share. Beautiful 68 Impala. Let me move forward. This next image is
real quick, bro.
What's up?
We're a little over time. Okay. I just want to let you know so you can
fire us a lecture.
But we love your lecture.
For sure. I'll wrap it up right here. Don't even chill. I had a video, but maybe at the end or something. If not, it's all good. I'll drop it in the chat. But this last image I'll share, and I appreciate you letting me know, is at Toucan's Corner for Sean Monterosa. Sean Monterosa was killed last year by Vallejo PD, Jared Todd. And the image is a mural that they did on this corner. It's of a toucan, because that was his graph name. The actual bird, though, with like a brim and a feather, with an FT, it says Fogtown on the... Around it, it has the Aztec design as well. There's a Huelga bird in the middle, which is like the black bird for the farmers movement, with the red in the bag. There's a Ben Davis, this is Frisco. There's an El Camino, that was his vehicle. He had an El Camino. And then you got like a shadowy outline of the city with the bridges. But yeah, basically, yeah, definitely like show your lifestyle, your art, your resistance, abolition, hold pigs accountable. I've got videos of like the DA throwing stuff at people and people throwing shit back at him. I got all kinds of history that we've documented that I could get into, but my friend told me, he says the job of the artist is to make like the revolution desirable, you know what I'm saying? Irresistible and stuff. I don't know if those are the exact words, but basically, you know, not every youngster is like, yeah, abolition, yeah, revolution, you know, but that's where you bring in your art and your talent, whether it be poetry, spoken word, rap, paintings or whatever, and you make it attractive and you show them what's out there, y'all. But I appreciate y'all. Thank you for allowing me to be in the space. I'm going to watch the other presenters go too, because I'm interested. Tongo's my homie. Shout out to Tongo. We actually were working together with youngsters out there in the point. But thank you. I'll pass it back to you, Alex.
Thank you so much, Jesus. I swear, like, if we had you a whole hour, we would have you on, because I believe everybody here tonight really wants to listen to what you have to say. But we're definitely going to have some more time towards the end of tonight during the Q&A for you to share some more of your wisdom. And yeah, let's give Jesus a round of applause and just like praise all his like energy towards liberation and soak it up, you know what I'm saying? Spread that shit. So yeah, I'm gonna pass it on to Tatiana, who is going to introduce the next speaker.
Thank you so much, Jesus. Like, damn, that was incredible. And just like how Alex said, I was like ready to just let you have the whole session. So, but of course, we got some really wonderful people coming up right now. We have Brass Liberation Orchestra, founder James Spector and members Candy Smallwood and Jordan Spector. Speak about BLO and share a video of themselves performing in solidarity with the Not One More campaign in the Immigrant Rights March. The Brass Liberation Orchestra makes loud on the streets to inspire, instigate, agitate, mourn, celebrate, and communicate. They stand in solidarity with groups and movements who are working for a more just and equitable world. They are a work in progress, and they work to build a multi-generational group that enhances and strengthens the culture of the left. Thanks, y'all, for being here.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having us. Hi, everyone. My name's Candy Smallwood. I am an African-American woman. I have a very thick, wavy hair that goes slightly past my shoulders. I'm wearing a black shirt that says no justice, no peace. And I'm sitting on a couch with some stuffed animals behind me. I have been in the BLO for, well, first I say I'm excited to be here. Frisco Lens, that was awesome. That was really awesome. I grew up in San Francisco. I grew up in the Bayview District. I grew up in Double Rock, which is housing projects, it still is. They moved it as part of redevelopment, but right by the Candlestick, what used to be Candlestick Park. My grandparents immigrated here. My great grandmother immigrated here in the 40s as part of workers in the shipyard, and San Francisco has been my home. It's pretty much the only place I've ever really lived. As someone who grew up in San Francisco, I've seen a lot of people I grew up with pushed out. And some of my siblings have had to live in other cities and other states to be able to afford a place to live. We're lifelong renters. And so we don't have a stake here. And so I've seen a lot of folks get pushed out. And so for many years, I've been doing housing work and working towards affordable housing, working with folks who are unsheltered, and really trying to do my part to make San Francisco a place for everybody, especially people who've lived their whole lives here, like me and my family and other folks. And as part of the housing work, that's how I encountered the Brass Liberation Orchestra. I encountered them at a housing action, and what really inspired me to join them was that this march went to different places in the nation and south of Market area where folks were being evicted or were facing evictions. And it was this long march, and it was just this amazing music that kept people encouraged to keep on moving and to keep going. And I think it was a couple hours, and the band just kept playing. And it was inspiring and it was wonderful. I played music growing up in San Francisco public schools, and I heard them and I wanted to play with them, and I've been playing with them since then. And it's just been an amazing experience. And I think one of the biggest things that I appreciate is being able to play music and keep people going, keep the actions going, because music is very healing. And no matter how I'm feeling and what I'm going through, I can play a tune or listen to a tune, and it just inspires me, and it keeps me, and it just keeps me motivated. And it reminds me that there's so many things. And I'm just so grateful to be able to play music as part of the housing work that I was doing. I'm now a lead attorney at the East Bay Community Law Center, I work on the decriminalization of poverty practice, where we work on fighting court debt, parking tickets, and trying to help folks who are, have just been saddled with debts by the courts. And, but I just, it's just, and being able to play music has just been really incredible. And I just wanted to plug that I originally graduated from City College of San Francisco with my AA degree in 2003. And so it's really cool to be here. But yeah, I wanna introduce Jamie Spector, who is one of the founders of the BLO. And then we'll play a short video and then Jordan will speak about our work.
Hey everyone, what an honor and pleasure to be here with you all. My name is Jamie Spector and I am talking to you from across the country. I'm in central Vermont on the traditional ancestral lands of the Nalhegan band of the Abenaki people, and definitely pay respects to them. And I am getting used to the visual introductions. Should I describe myself? I'm a middle-aged white woman. I use she, her pronouns. And I'm from Eastern European descent, Eastern European Jewish heritage. I'm an anti-Zionist Jewish person. Anti-capitalist Jewish person, and I have long straight brown hair, and my gray hairs are coming in good. Just turned 50 this summer, so I'm proud of all my gray hairs. So I was going to tell a little bit of how the BLO got started, the Brass Liberation Orchestra. In 2002, my sister and I and a group of friends, we were all mostly living, at that point, I think everyone was living in the Mission District. And we were all involved in various, you know, both paid work and activist work. Folks were educators, mental health workers, union organizers, artists, youth workers. And involved in various social justice struggles. And we were together talking about how we wanted to create a presence that could be a support and be in solidarity with social justice struggles and try to also be a contribute in our way to unifying the left to create more collective power of all the various struggles that were happening. And we're super inspired by the many traditions from around the world of protest music. So whether it's, you know, banda music or murga from Argentina, chindon music in Japan, you know, of course, the rich history among US civil rights movement of using music strategically in social justice struggles, the anti-apartheid movement, and super inspired by folks in the Bay who had also been doing it for years. Huge respect to Loco Bloco, who have been out on the streets and organizing young people for years. And so we got together and just, you know, we're also like Candy, people who had played, you know, some of the people had played music like in high school or middle school. I was sort of an outlier that I picked up a trombone at the age of 30 and said, I just love this instrument and I want to learn how to play it. I love the big sound of it. And I think our first time that we went out on the streets was in the mission in 2003 in solidarity with the Immokalee workers who were protesting. They were touring the country, and Jesus, you probably remember there was a Taco Bell at like Mission and 30th for years. And so we were marching through the mission to that Taco Bell that I think it's gone now. So we played to support that action. And, you know, we just really saw how, like Candy was saying, just to really elevate and try to sort of raise energy and support people to just sort of stay on the streets longer. Just the power of music was really strong. We, you know, we came together and we were a diverse group, multi-ethnic, multinational folks from various countries, and folks from, you know, different political and organizing traditions. And so one of the things that we did pretty early on, I think in 2003, was to really recognize and just name that we were coming from different sort of political traditions and cultural traditions, but to try to create a framework where we could be respectfully with each other. And so we spent many months hashing out through long meetings and discussion some political points of unity that I think are still in play. When I look, they haven't changed. So it's cool to see that almost 20 years later that they're still, folks still feel they're relevant. So I just thought I would like name those for folks. There's five of them. So our points of unity were, you know, first, just that music is liberation and just really recognizing the liberatory power of music, that it has been that way forever. And we just wanted to honor that tradition. Secondly, really centering racial and social justice and really being a group committed to doing whatever we could through our internal practices, you know, which is always a work in progress, but then also in sort of externally deciding what kinds of actions we're going to go out and support to sort of promote racial and social justice. We recognize that our third sort of point of unity is just recognizing a diversity of political strategies. You know, we had folks in the group who were coming from a strong anarchist tradition and, you know, really wanted to just focus on direct action on the streets. Other folks who are really committed to labor organizing. And so just really recognizing that there can be a diversity of political strategies and backgrounds in the group, but that we were going to focus our energy together on coming together and using music and to be in solidarity with groups. Fourth was just really centering a respect for culture really wanting to be conscious and intentional and careful, because we were choosing a repertoire of music from around the world that we did not want to contribute to cultural appropriation or disrespect at all. So we did our best to honor the different traditions and cultures that we were playing music from, and also have tried to find ways to bring that when we're playing out on the street by naming songs and giving some history and context for what we're playing so folks understand. And then finally, our last point of unity was just respect for the earth and really recognizing the crisis that we're in and the devastating impact of so many of our practices, and just wanting to be in right relationship with the land as best as we can. And I think, you know, just one last thing I would just say is just that we've really tried to have always sought to prioritize and support actions that are really led and organized by BIPOC folks and folks directly impacted. And, you know, I saw that there was a focus on countering the sort of white savior mentality. And that was a way that we really have tried to do that by, you know, when we're invited, people are like, oh, cool band, we want you at our action, but to really ask more questions like, okay, wait, who's organizing this action and where are they coming from? And, you know, are they, you know, are how connected are people with folks who are directly impacted and led by their leadership? So that's one way that we've tried to be in solidarity with folks.
Awesome. Thanks, Jamie.
Yeah.
And I want to share a video. This is from 2013. And can you hear the sound? Does the sound come through?
Can you play, press play? Let me see. Oh, it's not coming through. Can you take out the screen share? And then there should be a box that says screen share with sound.
Yeah, on the screen share thing.
Yeah. Got it. Yeah. Where, how many times I do this? I always forget to do something. All right. And just to describe the video, this is as part of the Not One More movement. And this is, it's a Immigrant Rise banner. And there's a march down Mission Street and the BLOs. Oh, no, I don't own a TV. Sorry.
You're good, Candy. Don't worry about it.
Do we have just one or two? Oh, I think we're...
Oh, no, we have 2 more minutes.
Yeah, you're okay. Good. You've got 2 more minutes.
Okay, Jordan. I wanted to introduce Jordan. Sorry, technology.
It's all good. Thank you so much, Candy, and thank you, Jamie. Thank you, Jesus. Tough act to follow. That was really cool. My name's Jordan. I'm a white man. I have my hair pulled back. I'm wearing glasses, a plaid shirt, and I'm in my room in Oakland. I also grew up in San Francisco, but like many of us with the housing crisis, me and my community have moved to the East Bay because I couldn't afford to live in the city anymore. Okay, real quick, there's three things that we do. I'm just going to give you the quick download of how we show up. We play at rallies, which you saw right there. And the whole role is to just like party pump the crowd, right? Because you could say like, shut down prisons. Like prisons shouldn't be happening, right? But if you have music happening and you're like, you know, we want safety in our town. No more prisons, shut them down. We want safety in our town. What? No more prisons, right? So you get a little, you know, we try to like make it engaging, right? Because like Jesus said, like, what we have is love to offer people, right? The right doesn't have that, but our art and culture can offer that, okay? The second thing is we do the same thing. We play the music, but we do it to fundraise. So I have a pen pal who was part of the hunger strikes in Pelican Bay. He helped organize that stuff. And we raised money for him to help pay for a parole attorney, which helped in that dude getting released. That dude has since been released. You know, and I'm not trying to like center our experience in this. I'm just saying that we're able to fundraise. So if you got something you need to fundraise for, let us know. We're out there. And the third thing is like direct moral support for people inside. There's been times where we've played outside prisons at noise demos and outside detention centers. And most recently we did this in Boston at a music festival with like 150 musicians and migrant justice activists. So some people would speak to their people inside. We played Matador, that song that you just heard. And we played another song called Cariñito, a really popular song from South America. And, you know, let the people inside know that people are outside still. The last thing I want to show you is just the power of music to convey a message. I'm a music teacher, so I'm going to share with you a music lesson. It's going to take 30 seconds that I do with my students to teach them the names of the parts of the violin. The idea behind this is I could tell you the names of the parts on the violin, but you're not going to remember it if I just tell you, you know, this is this and this is that. But if we do it together with some music, you're going to remember it. And this is kind of about how to show you how that by playing music and performing in the streets, we get the message across. So anyway, let me know if you can hear. Can you hear the music coming off my phone? Okay, great. Repeat after me. We're going to learn the parts of the mandolin. The head. Oh, wait. The head, not the bed. The pegs, not the eggs.
The strings, not the rings.
The fingerboard, not the sword. The bridge, not the fridge. The top, not the mop. Okay, cool. Fabulous. So I do that with my third graders because if I tell them, okay, third graders, these are the strings. This is the bridge. This is the fingerboard. You're like already asleep. You know what I mean? But if we put a little beat to it and we do a little song with it, now when I every time we go to that class, my students are like, oh, Mr. Stir, we want to sing that song. You know what I mean? So the music helps convey the message, whatever the message is. You know what I mean? So anyway, really respect your time. Thank you for putting this class together. It's an honor to be here. Please reach out to us if you have something that we want to go. Instagram page. I don't know if we're super tech savvy, but we got a website. I'll put a website in the chat, and we definitely need to get an Instagram page because I'll speak for myself. I'm a little behind the times.
Thank you so much, Jamie, Jordan, Candy. Everyone, let's give them a hand. Thank you, Brass Liberation Orchestra, for coming through for us. I have some very fond memories of y'all showing up for AFT marches for City College last spring. So thank you. We're gonna go ahead and start our break. We still have two presenters. We got Stephanie Woodward in the house and we have Tongo here. I saw Tongo in the participants list. But yeah, let's meet back here. Oh, Woodford, I'm so sorry. But let's all meet back here in 10 minutes and yeah, take a break.
All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome back from the break. I hope you took care of yourselves and nourished yourselves. So next up, I'm going to introduce Stephanie Woodford. Stephanie Woodford is a jazz and pop musician, singer, and composer. She is a graduate of both San Francisco Conservatory of Music Preparatory Division and also St. Ignatius College Prep High School. She has a degree in music from City College of San Francisco, and she's also a member of the CCSF Collective. Welcome, Stephanie.
Hello, Eric. Can everyone hear me? Let me mute it. You can hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay, cool. All right, my name is Stephanie. I'm a Black woman. I wear red glasses. Earlier, if you saw me, I had on a pink shirt. I changed my shirt because I wanted to look a little more fancy. It is white and gray striped shirt. I have my ukulele in front of me. My hair is braided. I just got it done. Some people asked me if it was cut. No, it's not cut, it's just braided. A lot of people have a tendency to change their hairstyles a lot. That one of those people is me. I do that every month. So, was I supposed to be talking about the music department? Oh no, Era just sent me a message. I got it. Okay, before I start singing, because it ties in to the song that I'm about to sing. Abolition is important to me because as a Black person, we're always fighting for freedom in this country. And for me personally, a lot of my heroes, and me included, fight that fight through our music. One of my heroes being Nina Simone. She always had a song for the abolition fight. And there are a lot of different artists, not just musicians, poets, photographers, brass band, a lot of different people and a lot of different music. You know, it's me and a few people were just talking about Lenny Carlson's jazz history class. There's some abolition talk in that class. And for the past few months, I have been writing songs about different aspects of racism and abolition. The last song being dedicated to Asian people and their fight to end Asian hate. I don't know when I'll put those songs out, but if I do, they'll probably be on SoundCloud. I would announce that. And like I said, I use music to express how I feel about different things. With abolition to express, my first song tied in abolition was called Hands Up, Don't Shoot. It had to do with Trayvon Martin. I was so distraught and so just lost when I heard about that. So I wrote that song. And so tying that up into what I'm about to do, the song that I'm about to perform is called Blackbird. It's by Nina Simone, one of my sheroes. And she wrote this song about a Black woman in the time period she was in and how Black women specifically were made in condition to feel like no one was there for them. You know, even getting out of slavery times, just in Jim Crow, no one is there for Black people, but specifically Black women. And, you know, Paul McCartney has a song called Blackbird. It's about the same thing, Black women and the racism that we experience. And today we still experience, you know, that racism, Black people, BIPOC people, I should say that, BIPOC people, LGBT people, we still experience racism, homophobia, all kinds of different things. And so this is why I wanted to perform this song called Blackbird by Nina Simone.
Why you wanna fly, Blackbird? You ain't never gonna fly. Why you wanna fly, Blackbird? You ain't never gonna fly. No place big enough for holding all these tears you're gonna cry. Your mother's name was only, and your daddy's name Pain. And they called you Little Sorrow, 'cause you'll never love again. Oh, 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 why you wanna fly? Blackbird, you ain't never gonna fly. So, oh, 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 why you wanna fly? Blackbird, you ain't never gonna fly. You ain't got no one to hold you. You ain't got no one. If you'd only understand this, nobody wants you anywhere. So, oh, 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 why you wanna fly, Blackbird? You ain't never gonna fly. Oh, oh, why you wanna fly, Blackbird? You ain't never gonna fly. You ain't got no one to hold you. You ain't got no one to care. If you'd only understand it, nobody wants you anyway. So why you wanna fly, Blackbird? You ain't never gonna fly.
Thank you very much. Oh yeah. That's my take on abolition. I do it through music.
Thank you so much, Stephanie. That was beautiful. I'm going to pass it to Tatiana to introduce Tongo.
Okay. Thank you so much, Stephanie. That was absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's time for Tongo. Tongo Eisen-Martin is a poet, educator, and organizer. Whose work centers on issues of mass incarceration, extrajudicial killings of Black people, and human rights. He has taught at detention centers around the country and at the Institute for Research in African American Studies at Columbia University. Tongo, I am so happy to see you here. I'm always happy to see you. So here we go. I'm gonna hand it over to you.
Right on. Appreciate you all. You know, I'm a long way from home, in strange environments, and I'm a little tired. But I appreciate any patience you can extend me as I try to make some sense for you. I intend to speak on poetry as a tool of revolution. But I would like to pan out and frame this tool with the lens of what needs to be healed, or how does art in general actually become a tool of humanization, and what is it actually remedying? I'm not making any assumptions on people's familiarity with revolutionary theory. So forgive me if what I say you already know. But I think that one of the, you know, what we always have to be, what we have to start becoming aware of, and organize ourselves in relationship to, is the acknowledgement of the oppressor that lives in our head, the oppressor that is been beaten into our consciousness, and is daily reinforced in our consciousness by the various aggressions of this superstructure, or the superstructure that serves the white ruling class. A term that we have to all be familiar with is alienation of labor. Now this is 101, right? Basically, the idea is that what does a worker or how does a worker subsist or survive or reproduce themselves? We reproduce ourselves by actually selling a piece of ourselves, which is our labor. And yes, this comes from the 101 analysis of industrialization, in industrialization era capitalism, but this applies to all efforts, not just blue collar. The second your mind and body perform something, and that something is sold to an employer, you have alienation of labor begins. But why the term, or what's important about the word alienation within it, is that so we know that our efforts, as they are harnessed by a job or by an institution, they don't just they serve an interest that actually contradicts ours, right? So it's not necessarily like a fair exchange if at the end of the day that institution or that company, that boss, that capitalist takes what you've given them, what you've sold to them, and uses it to reinforce a position of power that ensures your powerlessness. So this is why it's alienation of labor, or your labor becoming alien to you, almost to connote that your labor actually becomes enemy to you. In another way, you actually become enemy to yourself by joining or by being coerced into this relationship with the system. This equation, though, it's not just the rallying call of like, well, we demand the right to not be the enemies of ourselves. This equation is important psychologically, because this process of perpetually giving pieces of yourself to actually an enemy's agenda has extreme psychological consequences.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Am I supposed to stop?
No, I think that was a mistake.
Oh, okay.
You can go on.
All right, right on. So as a consequence, we basically live compartmentalized. And you can just think about, your life in terms of the different selves you embody in order to navigate this reality. And you think about yourself simply just like, you know, you have a you that's doing like, this is me doing what I want to do. This is me doing what I have to do. You often hear people's, the various monologues of society end or begin with, hey, it is what it is, right? This is what we, this conformity has deep psychic consequences. One of the major ones is this inhibition or this belief that actually you do not have the right to determine your reality. You do not, that all of you, that you don't really, you shouldn't have any power in the first place. And that any power, or that any power you have, should be wielded by an oppressor. I got the right on. I would like to talk about this a little bit. What is this consciousness, this oppressive and oppressing consciousness that we have internalized? What is the outlook of our oppressors that we have internalized that keeps us in this that basically makes us easy to control? And what I'm warning my comrades, or warning comrades here, that also makes our resistance easy to contain. Because you have to always think like, well, what of the actual oppressor am I bringing in to what is supposed to be a revolutionary process? I'm gonna give you all a few quotes from Paulo Freire. A lot of this stuff, what I'm saying, I mean, you know, you could don't take it from me, just go ahead and read Pedagogy of the Oppressed. I like Freire's frame in that he equates revolution really with humanization, almost defines revolution as just the true humanization, or the true reabsorption of all of the powers that we give away daily to our oppressor. So one thing he says, the oppressor's consciousness, and again, this is what we've internalized, tends to transform everything surrounding it into an object of domination. The earth, property, production, the creations of people themselves, time, everything is reduced to the status of objects at its disposal. So the objective of the ruling class, careful, because it's actually an objective that you've internalized yourself, that I've internalized myself, and that so it has to constantly be deconstructed, both through the work of analysis and also the work of praxis. You know, we clarify our consciousness through the programs we engage in. But the ruling class wants to turn us all into objects, basically. Or you could also look at it as turn us into ghosts, to live kind of dead to yourself, like a tool is, completely deanimated, and only come to life or enjoy a feeling of aliveness when doing an activity or job or function that the ruling class prescribes, right? All of which, you know, furthers their power. So it's like you're politically dead until it's time to vote, right? You're emotionally dead until you buy that car, right? This is the This is the consciousness that this reality is actually enforcing, both through means of you know, through coercion of all types, both of, you know, whether it's violence, enforcing hegemony through violence, or through, you know, putting various carrots on various sticks and leading us around, say, hey, no, you know, give up your true power, and I will, you know, and I will grant you something. Again, the effect is that we're really walking around here in a ghost-like state, and that's you know, this is why, you know, they say, or one of the reasons why we could say that capitalism is a death cult. You know, I think Freire even actually likens a oppressive society to a necrophilic party. Okay, so it's basically in the ruling class's best interest to have a mass of people who do not believe that they should have a critical role in the historical process, and therefore do not even try. It's in the ruling class' best interest to slow down social evolution. So, because the slower social evolution is, the easier people are to domesticate, because the more you slow social evolution, or give the illusion that that everything is all right, just let the system have its time, the easier it is to present history, and again, like Freire said, time itself is something that can't be domesticated. You also see the ruling class, or this ruling class mentality, this oppressor's mentality, trying to compartmentalize social evolution, right? So we think, you know, okay, we have the reality of police and prisons, and that exists in its kind of own autonomy. We have realities of the health care system, or you see the, you know, health structures, how it handled, you know, how it handled the pandemic. You have autonomies of education. You have all of these kind of various fields. You have all these various fields of reality, or the production of reality. Also, good, man. I appreciate you. Right on. You have all of these sites that we take up arms in, that we struggle in, and we define ourselves through. But the problem is, we engage them as if they're on their own path, at their own trajectory, instead of one situation of oppressor versus oppressed, or an oppressor that has control over all, or that harnesses all of these different facets of reality in order to ensure their power. Okay, which does what then? It also builds in you the idea that there are certain aspects of life that are not necessarily your concern, or not necessarily not necessarily important to engage in, or not necessarily necessary to transform, right? We know the entire system has to be transformed. So you know, it, which also, when you compartmentalize social evolution, what they love to do, and you know, what's the best way to do it? When we live in terms of our comfort zones, or our talents, or our interests, when we accept these the myth of kind of archipelago. The multiple islands of reality. What happens is they can keep your attention on material that is alien to you, or get you to feel like, well, reality is produced in galaxies far away by people that are more relevant to you, more relevant than you, right? And that ultimately that there are aspects of society that really are just beyond your interest, so that you should not interfere with oppression no more. Like you didn't like biology, and therefore biology is not for you. You shouldn't interfere with the certain matters of power. You shouldn't fight this municipality. You shouldn't stand up for kids in cages in South Texas, or Haitians getting whipped. You can sit out this fight. What's the brother they're gonna execute in Oklahoma in a couple of days, Julie or something, right? All these fights you can sit out because because we're not engaging the totality of the picture, okay? So what this does is what the cumulative effect does is it atrophies it atrophies the parts of our mind that could define reality, and this kind of is where where you can look at a revolutionary art as a good place to enter, because to write or to create or really to present your recreation of reality is to name reality, is to define it, and that's the beginning of this inhibition I'm sorry, y'all, there's all kind of noises and stuff going on around. It's hard to, like I said, I zigged when I should zagged, and now I'm at the whim of a city, but the beginning of inhibition in our minds, right, is that idea that, hey, this reality is not for me to define and not for me to transform. To write, to make a statement, to say what's important, to talk about what's going on with you is the first step in reclaiming and reabsorbing that power to define reality. Let me know if I should shut up or you could put a little bit more on it. I don't know, but
10 minutes, Tongo.
Oh, okay. All right, groovy. So what is then the revolutionary lens? So that was a very rough rundown of the oppressor's lens that we view things for. What is a revolutionary lens? A groovy thing to go with that jives very well with art is revolutionary development is a matter of humanization, to not be reduced to an object, and to enter a socialization, right? To enter a social arrangement or agreement in which every aspect of your existence is nurtured and given the opportunity to develop, Now, everything is either the practice of slavery, or the practice of the practice of liberation. Everything is the practice of slavery or the practice of liberation. So what, you know, both what socializations your craft joins or co-creates, and how you experience your craft, or really your human output in general, you know, can be gardened in relationship to that fact. Again, the reabsorption of all of your powers, of the powers of determining complete reality, including determining your military reality, because that's all, you know, when we talk about what is policing, what is prisons, it's how they determine the realities of violence, or how they use it, and how that determine a violence to reinforce, to ensure ruling class hegemony. This is a power you can reabsorb. So when we talk about, you know, we're a long way from even beginning to kind of codify. And far be it for me to ever, you know, I'm the last one to be trying to tell anybody engage in revolutionary violence. But this is the beginning of what we have to come to terms with, is that this is a power we have to reabsorb. And we can look at that. We can look at that issue, come to terms with realities of violence, and figuring out how do we actually organize ourselves, holding up to that guiding fact that. We will always be powerless until we also reabsorb our power to determine a military reality. But to return to the art though, or the kumbaya, the fun of analysis, really, which really you could say art is. While they would have us engage reality as if it's created away from us, or created in these different pockets, or in some kind of suspended animation in which all you need to worry about is what you're immediately interested in or worried about, solution then is what? To look for whole pictures. And I think, poetry, this is why it's groovy, because we're always pointing out, no, like this is like that, and that's a part of this. And we're constantly, or it just so happens that a thought gets very musical when you present it in relationship to the bigger picture. Or I can make the description of something small very musical when within that description I reveal the bigger picture in which is taking place. So regardless of what your craft is, we have to look for the whole pictures, right? And also understand that within our immediate situation, within our immediate surroundings, the bigger picture is the bigger picture is here. Okay. Again, back to this kind of this inhibition that's interestingly actually reinforced through counter-revolutionary art, is this idea that you're not smart unless you sound like them. You can't tell me anything about the universe unless you use the evidence, you know, some kind of, you know, that basically white people are the keepers of civilization and in scientific discovery. And if you don't talk like them, if you don't quote the people they quote, if you don't sound like they sound, if you don't write like they write, you don't actually have anything, you don't have any actual worthy investigation. When, you know, what we do with our art, what we assert is that, no, my immediate, like everything that is me or everything that I flow from, everyone who, you know, from the blood to the ideas, everything that's mine can define the universe just as brilliantly as anything anybody, you know, any white supremacist hero or heroine could ever can say or do. That my voice is just fine. My father's voice is just fine. My grandmother's voice is just fine. And telling you everything about the universe, and this is a power tool, as brought to you by art. Now you know, and I'm sorry. How much time do I have now?
You got a minute.
I got a minute. Well, yes, for sure. Well, in conclusion, almost a conclusion that's almost a new departure point. The bottom line is that we're not, like the world has seen an abolition before, literally, right? But the ruling class was not abolished. Therefore, the principal contradictions of the society didn't change. Here we are doing this over and over and over and over and over again. Until we have a complete, social transformation, the complete transformation of social reality, we're always going to end up with you know, millions of sentient beings dying for nothing brutally. I won't start a poem. Moral of the story is, with you know, you can, instead of what we tend to do, which is conform our psyches to these oppressive realities, we have to now conform our MOs, or conform our praxis to that fact that social transformation is needed, and social transformation does look like certain specific things, and we can then, you know, kind of build a praxis to that. And art is always there for you, and there's always a beautiful organizing tool, because again, it's your engagement of reality at the most intimate, nuanced levels. A lot can get kind of swept under the rug when we say, we're gonna go over here and yell at them, or we're gonna go over here and demand this, and it's some heroic stuff. You know what I mean, bro? If God forbid they put me on death row for some bullshit, I don't know. Please come protest. I'm not knocking them. Please come save my life, you know. But you know, we have to engage, you know, all of what goes on, all of what has got us in this position, right? And art is just a art is a beautiful is a beautiful tool of liberation, because it lives on the engagement of all of the small moments of life. It exposes all of the small relationships you have to your reality, in which this oppressor thrives and hides and infects and implodes and does all of these things to undermine resistance. And sorry, that's the best. That's the best I could do.
All
right. All right. Well, thank you, Tongo. Please stick around. We're about to have a Q&A, unless you're too exhausted otherwise. We totally understand.
I'm here.
Okay. Are you reading anytime soon? Where can folks see your work?
I'm not sure. If you just tap in with me. Here, I'll put my email in the chat. Just hit me and I can tell you intelligent things.
You should have your own hotline.
Thank you so much, Tongo. So we're gonna go into the BIPOC Q&A. It will be 10 minutes Q&A for BIPOC class members. BIPOC folks, please raise your hand if you'd like to ask a question, or type something in the chat to let us know that you'd like to speak, or that you'd like to have your question read aloud for you. We'll open up questions from everyone in the last 5 minutes, and then after the Q&A, we will go into breakout room discussions. Actually, I think we're skipping the breakout rooms tonight. So no, we're all together tonight. This is the breakout room. And so, yeah, please remember to send a message to the person. Oh, wait, no, never mind. You don't need to say that. So we're all together tonight. Anyway, we're going to start with the question for all of our presenters that we ask every session. And the question is, in your wildest dreams, how do you imagine us creating an abolitionist world, and how does this overlap with CCSF?
I'll take a hit on that. I don't know. I feel like abolition is a step towards revolution. I feel like revolution is like the real goal, you know what I'm saying? And to get there, we're gonna need a word of abolition. But I think in my wildest dreams, I'm always thinking just like, yeah, we'll get together, do some manny stuff and shit. But my homie always reminds me, like, we gotta provide the alternative, bro. Like, literally, like, there's houseless folks, there's people who ain't eating, there's people suffering, all kinds of shit. Like, we gotta provide the alternative, not just want like this whole like anarchy thing, which is nothing wrong with that, but like, we need to provide the alternative. We need to look out for each other. You know, we gotta do things. I don't know. I mean, I'm an individual, so I'm more eye for an eye, and I know it's not always the case. And you know, some restorative justice also as well, but definitely a world where it's like, get rid of whatever's currently in place, like eradicate that, like for sure. Don't even call it United States of America, none of those words. And like, you know what I'm saying? Really, like, not let it be like one leader or multiple leaders, like just everyone has a fair say. I don't know. I try to go back to like traditional ways, you know what I'm saying? Where like people used to be able to trade stuff or like grow stuff. And I'm from this part, so here's fish. And I'm from this part, here's herbs and spices, which I know we're far from that. We're like in a different era now, but just basically creating alternatives. My OG, you know, homegirl tells me like, bro, do you even know how to like grow vegetables and hunt animals? Like, are you trained for this? I'm just like, dang, like a lot of like, you know, folks tend to see just like the violent anarchy part, but we got to really like prep and really have all these, you know, the education, the, you know, I think with my photography, I always know it's just like a historians writing stories about what's going on in the world, and we're not in that book, and it's going to be passed on to our children and shit. So we got to document our own history. And I think the City College is a start, like, to have a class, a whole semester on abolition. Like, that's wild. I never thought we were going to have that. That's dope, you know? So it's like an honor to be able to speak and be a part of that and to plant seeds, you know? I'm pretty sure what people do it online now. I remember going through the books and be like, huh, what am I going to choose? Like, oh, abolition. Yeah, for sure, taking that. Like, it's not college success no more, right? It's abolition. So, yeah, it's dope. I think it all ties in. Everyone's going to have to play their role. It's definitely a village. No one's more important than anyone else. Decolonize as much as possible and go back to traditional ways of not just like indigenous, but also like African, like traditions and practices, things that work, that were working, that currently still work. You know what I'm saying? Like specifically, like even with like Western medicine and stuff like that, like I'm barely digging into the tip of the iceberg of that, you know. I'm learning. There's a lot for me to learn and to grow, but yeah, that's just like a little general spill for sure.
I was going to say learn 50 college success. I took that class almost 2 decades ago. One thing that I just want to piggyback on that and just say, for me, one of the things that one of our chants that as part of the BLO is in our repertoire is, you know, no borders, no walls, sanctuary for all. And for me, I really think about community and how, you know, how so much of this is about community and how we've gotten in this point. And I'm not familiar with Pedagogy of the Oppressed, but I will be. I'm going to check it out. Definitely. But for me, I just think we live in a society now where it's all about, like, you know, just individualism and fighting each other, and you know, we're all being pulled apart, and it's becoming like, you know, we're pulling apart out of this pettiness of stuff, right? And I think for me, I just think that, you know, I think that for me, it's just about community and how we can grow together, how we can learn together, and how we can teach each other and move in a way that we're not, you know, in competition or in opposition, but we're just together. And I think that so much more can happen if we are together. And I was reading the We Will Not Cancel Us recently, Adrienne Marie Brown, and I just found that her words are just like about how we have this call out culture has become so prevalent in our communities with the, you know, mob mentality, and how it's like, how can we rethink what we're doing and think about how is this helping us or is this further dividing us? For me, it's just about how we can move together towards this shared vision. And I think that this class is amazing, you know, and it's just, it's uplifting folks who traditionally are not uplifted. And I think that's really important.
I gotta go, y'all. Just wanted to say real quick, that just like, man, wildest dream is just a kind of sense of people, just a people who are just living in a beautiful revolutionary process and how it manifests. I say too, you know, there's a kind of a groovy, you know, there's a groovy kind of aspect of like kind of a revolution 101 is the idea that actually be in love with the future generations who will really extend the kind of the fruition of a revolution. That as much as we would love to, you know, as much as I would love to live in communist Wakanda, you know what I mean? that's not necessarily the fate of my mind, right? You know, here's our turn to do right by a resistance that will give birth to the generations that will know what to do in ways that we can't imagine. All I just want to see in the future, tomorrow and the day after and on, is just more and more people who have just come to a healthy, beautiful process of humanizing themselves and humanizing each other. And I think, you know, the rest will take care of itself. But my time is up in this space. I gotta go. Yeah, man, so much love and solidarity to y'all.
Thank you so much, Tongo. It was a pleasure to have you. It was a treat to have you.
Right on.
Yeah. Thank you, Tongo. Take good care.
I'll see y'all in the streets. You know what I mean? You know how we get down. So.
Yeah, so right now, if anyone has any other questions that they want to ask the speakers, it would be a great time to do so. Open to everyone at this point, but if you are a BIPOC person that has a question or a comment, or
yeah, I got a question. Was there, could you name a piece of art, like music, a mural, a photograph, a book, or something that you feel radicalized you, or like you can trace your political awakening back to?
Tupac and Marvin Gaye and Bob Marley. I feel like they're very alike in their messaging. They sound hella different, but I just, since a little boy, like I'm talking about like elementary school age, I got older sisters and brothers and stuff. So like music's always been in my life, but you know, just that freedom fighter, like fuck the government. Just kind of like telling the truth and doesn't care what people think. And then Bob Marley, just endless love, compassion for the children, for the woman, for the people, for life. And Marvin Gaye, man, just, oh, he was a beautiful person. I love his music. Tupac's song, Thug's Mansion, Poor Man's Blues, Pawns in the Game by Mac Dre. Y'all should definitely look into that. It's more like educational. I like DMX. He used to get me pumped up. Just music, it kind of guided me through the whole shit, you know? And I think something that radicalized me that wasn't really like a art per se, but it was a song. I think I was in fourth grade, and when the whole 9/11 had literally just happened, we were sent home, everybody was scared, teachers were crying. I'm in elementary school, and you know, I'm a brown Mexican kid. My father, you know, my stepdad always told me like, be proud to be Mexican, and, you know, just don't forget where you're from kind of thing, even if you're born here or whatever, right? But I came back and the teacher was a white woman from Michigan. And she was trying to make every single student sing the Star Spangled Banner for everybody, a 30 kid classroom. And I was like, I can't sing. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not singing this shit. And there was people up there like singing and breaking down, crying, like trying to get through this. And she was just so forced. And when I went up there, she was trying to make me sing it. I started crying. As a little fourth grader, I didn't want to sing it. And she told me, you better sing it. She didn't say it, but it's like, you Mexican, so you for sure got to sing it. Like, you being in this country. She didn't say it, but I felt that kind of vibes, and I didn't sing it. And she told me I wouldn't pass the fourth grade because of it. I told my older sister, and she went off on her in a teacher meeting, whatever. But I stopped doing the Pledge of Allegiance and started all that shit right then and there. I've never done it again, pre-Kaepernick, even though all love and respect to him for standing up. But just that radicalized me right then and there as a youngster. I was like, I ain't doing none of that shit, bro. So I've been at, people look at me, I'm like, I'll fight you for this shit, bro. Like, I don't want to, but like, you ain't gonna force me to do anything. Like, I'm so strong and standing where I stand. And I'm not hella like pro-Mexico, because that government shit too. Just governments in general, you know? But just, yeah, that radicalized me. I remember that. That's a key moment in my life. Plus all the music. And yeah, definitely Thug's Mansion. I like what Tupac says in the song, like how he describes this beautiful place where we could just chill and kick it, and just there doesn't have to be war, it could be peace, dice games and shit, like shit that we're not hurting no one, and you know, it's peaceful. And I think he says, seen the politicians banners, the red seals locked, and cages peace explain why they can't stand us. You know what I'm saying? I'm just like, dang, they do red seals locked in chains and cages and to just let us be. But yeah, a lot of Tupac, a lot of Mac Dre, Bob Marley, and Marvin Gaye, and in that particular moment.
For me, I went to my elementary school. I love music. I've always loved music. My elementary school was called Sir Francis Drake, but now it's Malcolm X Academy. And we used to sing Lift Every Voice and Sing. And you know, and that song, even every time I hear that song and every time I sing that song still always just, it fills me with pride. It just reminds me of who I am and where I've come from and the work that still needs to be done. And I think that song has always been, it's just always been an inspiration to me. And I think sometimes, you know, there's three verses. We usually only sing one, but even now, like I'm the second oldest of eight, and we all went to Philip Burton High School on Manziel at the off of San Bruno in San Francisco at the top of the hills, and we used to walk those hills every day. And I and my youngest brother graduated just in June, May, June, from there. And he was originally the last Smallwood, but now my nephew goes there. So the bloodline continues at that school. But he graduated from there, and this is the second year they had a graduation for Black folks, and it was at Kezar. And it was just, it was a ceremony for Black folks and graduating high school, and it was amazing. And they announced all the colleges everyone was going to, and they announced what they were doing after they finished. And it was just amazing. It was so amazing. And it was like really cool. And it was really nice that they had it in the pandemic, because the first time, it was the second one. The first one they had was, it was on the Zoom, I think, but this one was in person. So I got to watch him graduate, and they sung Lift Every Voice and Sing. And it's just such an inspiring tune. And that, I think that's the song that really, that when I think about my work and I think about what I do, I think that song just always stays with me.
Thank you so much for answering those questions. I really like, I remember that song, and I do remember, I didn't go to Burton, but I had friends that went there, so I remember walking up those hills too. And yeah, I do recommend everyone to like listen to some of the like early Mac Dre and like early Tupac songs too. Pac has a dope ass song called Panther Power. He has some really, really good songs that I don't think people highlight from when he was younger. And yeah, so I appreciate you both answering that. I do have, before there are any, does anyone have any other questions that they want to ask? I did get an anonymous one, so unless they're...
I think Luis asked how we can invite Brass Liberation Orchestra to an action in the South Bay.
Yeah, so we are, and if anyone ever wants to play with us, we are always looking for folks to come and join us. Our website is Brass Liberation, brassliberation.org. And on there you can, it's a little clunky, but it's a great website, but on there you can ask, you can set, you can go to contact us, and there's an option where you can put in a gig request. And basically how it works is you put in a gig request, and we'll ask more questions, and then we'll see if we can get a band. We have played in the South Bay. We have played all around California, and you know, have car, we'll travel. And so if we can get a band, we'll definitely try to be there. And if it doesn't work, you can always email me, or if you have questions, you can always email me. Oh wait, sorry, private message that. I don't know how I did that. Oh, technology.
I can send it.
That's okay. Just
do it to me.
there you go. There you go. Thank you. There you go. Cool. Thank you. Yeah. And feel free to check out the website and send a gig request, or just reach out to me and I'll see what we can do. And we do not charge. This is our gift to the movement.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm down to see who's trying to go and learn how to play a new instrument. I know how to play the triangle. So the anonymous question we have, which will be the last question of the night since we're at almost closing. So the question is that Tongo had mentioned having a strong lens and having a total picture. How do you see that being created in the art scene in San Francisco in relation to your own craft?
For me, hopefully I haven't misunderstood the question. For me, it's the desperate. Like I said, I have siblings who do not live here anymore. I have a sister who lives in Arkansas. And you're like, what are you doing in Arkansas? And it's just like, well, when she moved to Arkansas, she could get a one bedroom for $450. So she moved to Arkansas, and, you know, and folks are moving there. There are a lot of folks from, you know, California are moving to Arkansas. And so for me, I have nieces and nephews, and they're growing up. Some of them live in Sassoon. Some of them still live in San Francisco and in public housing. And I just see, and San Francisco is the biggest small town ever, right? How many of us walk down the street and we run into everybody we know? You know, it's like, it's all the time. I have run into a lot of people that I went to high school with or that I grew up with that are unhoused. And I think about my family having to not be able to live in the city they grew up in. And I feel that desperate need to have folks who built this city and earned this city and deserve this city, you know, to deserve to be here. And so for me, that's what is kind of the big picture for me, is being able to do my part to make this city a place where we can stay. And that's like whenever I think about my work and my art, I think that the music really, you know, my you know, activism has come through music. It's, you know, and so for me, it was housing activism, and it was, you know, and so for me, it's just, what can I do to keep this city affordable, or to make this city affordable, or to change the tide of affordability so that my nephews and nieces will have a roof over their heads when they get older? Because I don't have a house, so I don't have a place where they can crash right now. And so what can I do to make it? And so for me, that kind of drives my art, and that drives what I do.
So me, I love to surround myself with other artists, not just artists, you know, definitely a people person, but like, it's inspiring. I like to be inspired by different people. But one thing I learned along the way is just keeping the culture alive. Like we're losing a lot of what, you know, Frisco once was. And we're like fighting tooth and nail just to keep like our culture alive. So if we see something, you know, like, shit, I get excited when I see loud music in the neighborhood and people are uncomfortable. I'm like, hell yeah, bro. Like, you know, like nice. I love riders. So when we come through with the old schools and we shut the streets down and people are like, I got to go places. And we got the music loud. And we're like, bro, we've been here for hella years. Like, y'all just got here, you know what I'm saying? And all these murals, like, I'm trying to document murals from like local artists before they get buffed out or erased or taken down. Be in communication with folks. Do something that's not fucking like through the city, through city funding, you know what I'm saying? Do something that's like fucking radical and on the spot on the streets, and not everyone got to know that you did it. Shit. Sometimes you can't be like, hey, it was me, y'all. You know, I mean, the people that matter know, but you got to give, man. I like to see more selfless folks, selfless artists in the city, where it's like, it's not about them. It's about giving to the village. And for the youngsters, man, the youngsters are watching. There's a lot of folks like in the nonprofit world and elder folks just playing them out and misguiding them and telling them things are cool, like letting them breathe, and the cops and all this shit, that they're not cool at all. And we got to be like, nah, bro, like, we got to speak up. Shit, we were kids one day, and they told us we're the future. Now it's the future, and here we are. So let's run it. Let us dictate how we gonna do this. And you know what I'm saying? Just really, just the truth. With the truth, always document the truth. And like I mentioned earlier, like, there's a history book being written and we're not in it. So when I take pictures, it's like, I wanna make sure, like, okay, we were here, we were there. Like, that shit mattered, it counted. Like, I don't want it to just, we gonna transition one day and not be here, you know what I'm saying? So what are we gonna leave for people to remember us, that we were here, you know? Cause if not, I'd be watching movies in San Francisco and it's like the cable car and the pier and the bridge, and there's not like no Black or Brown or Samoans or Filipinos or Asians, none of that. Just I'm all like, bro, that's why people think what they think about the city. That's all they're gonna portray about us. So we gotta, you know, like, I travel too, so I'm like, I got people in LA, what's up, Frisco, you know? And my homie's like, bro, I never seen so many LA fools happy to see a Frisco kid. I'm like, shit, me neither, bro. Like, you know, it's crazy, but it's all love. I come through with love. I document their city. Then when I go to Oakland, I've been to Arizona, but I always represent my city, man. I'll go out there in a Giants jersey, you know, and just be like, hey, man, that's where I'm from. Like, I'm not with the shit, none of that, but I'm from the city and you can't take that from me. It's just, that's just where I'm from, man. But yeah, just keeping the culture alive is key, as much as you can, whether it's through music, whether it's through poetry, through photography, through your paintings, through whatever, just how you carry yourself, the things you do, the things you wear, buying like local clothing instead of whatever bougie stuff is out there nowadays. And yeah, keep buying local as much as you can too. Like, you know, I in terms of like food, I try to get food from like someone I know. In terms of like clothing, or if I need a photographer, I'll get someone I know that's like Black or Brown. If I need a construction worker, it's gonna be a Black or Brown person. Like, everything, that just keep it here, because, you know, the corporate motherfuckers got money, y'all. Like, they don't need our money anymore. But with that being said, I was gonna ask, oh yeah, shout out to Kova's Light right on, that's my mom's business. I was gonna ask if I could just put a video real quick, if I could share my screen, a quick little 3-4 minute video that I did. I did it a couple years back. Right on. There's some folks in there that I don't really mess with no more when I did it, but at the time, this is what was going on in history. I'm over it. So if y'all want to hit me directly, feel free. Hey, what's up with this person? I'm always open to convo. But it's a dope video. Overall, it's just a lot of stuff with weak-ass George Gascon and the Frisco Five and, you know, cop watching, all that shit, a lot of stuff going on. So I'm going to share my screen. It's a dope little video I want to share earlier. And yeah, maybe wrap up with this.
Yeah, this will be a perfect way to close out. So thank you.
Cool.
For sure. Enjoy, everybody.
Is everything cool? All right. Can y'all hear it? Can y'all hear it?
Yeah. Yeah, it sounds good.
Appreciate y'all letting me share that with y'all, man. But yo, did that a couple years back. Fucking tears in my eyes, I was doing it. And it's a beautiful video. Some people ain't here no more in that video. And it was just dope. The music. That's what I'm saying. I love Bob Marley. I'm not just telling you, like, you know what I'm saying? But I'm glad. Thank you for letting me share that with y'all. I appreciate y'all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, both of you. And thank you everyone for coming out tonight and staying till 8:30. I know as it's getting darker earlier, it's harder to stay up, but yeah, this was really beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Everyone have a really good night. Take care of yourselves. Dream about abolition and what you can do tomorrow to get closer to it, even if it's just a little thing.
So,
water those seeds that we planted tonight.
Mm-hmm. Well, y'all stay beautiful, man. I'll see y'all.
Hey, y'all.
See y'all soon. Have a good night, everybody.
Bye. Bye.